Elvis was making breakfast while Steele, Boyce and Penny were chatting away.
That's when I saved that person from lighting a match in a gas-filled room. My, what a fool that person was.
Yes, indeed. He thought it was just fog, although I didn't see how fog could get inside a factory floor.
Well, I'm sure no one here would be daft to do that.
Indeed. Well, anyway, how's breakfast coming along, Crittington?
It's done now, sir. This morning's dish, omelette à l'orange.
The others thought that dish sounded rather odd, but after a taste, they surprisingly liked it.
Not bad, I should say, sir.
Yes, not bad at all.
They eventually finished the breakfast and resumed their daily antics. Steele went back to his office, but unfortunately, dropped something. Elvis picked the thing up, but looked at it and was interested. He then started to read it.
At around 3:30 p.m. on August 28th, 1950, fireman Basil Steele saved a senior fireman named Ian Hennigan from being flattened by lamppost by a burning building. Today he will be awarded with a medal at local fire station. Whoa, that's impressive. Hang on. 28th of August. That's today, sir. Sir?
What is it, Fireman Crittington?
Haven't you said today was the 40th anniversary of when you saved someone?
Steele was confused, but when he saw Elvis point to the newspaper article, his eyes widened with terror.
How did you get that? Was this your scam?
No, sir, you dropped it.
Well then, give it back!
Steele angrily snapped it back into his hand and started to walk back to his office.
But sir, how come you haven't said this before? This is something grand to celebrate.
It's not that grand. Continue the cooking.
But sir, I didn't see how anyone would keep this as a secret. Not even Chief Boyce.
I said continue cooking, Crittington. Is this because he's better than you?
Steele was enraged. He was about to shout at Elvis, but he took a second to think and sighed. He turned to Elvis and said in a calm, sorrowful voice,
Elvis, whatever your first name is, Crittington, could you come to my office, please?
Elvis, while a bit scared, walked into Steele's office. Boyce quietly walked towards the wall and silently listened to their conversation.
If you want to know, yes, I did save someone from being flattened. But it's more deeper than that. Care to take a listen?
Sure. Station Officer Steele, sir?
Well, then. It was a while back. Me and Boyce were good friends since our childhood. We just came out of World War II a few years ago and made us want to do heroic acts, like our mothers and fathers, who fought at that event. At the age of 18, we joined the fire service. We were a bit slow to start, but we eventually got there. However, Boyce started to change.
How so?
Well, he became more egotistical. He got more attention than me, and even earned the respect of being the main senior fireman, Ian Hennigan. I was quite clumsy and made mistakes. People saw me as a fool, and it got me quite a bit. So I decided to retire from the fire service a bit and join the army until nearby.
I talk out to be in good shipshape fashion. After 3 months, I came back to the fire service, and the first call out I attend was fire at a corner shop.
Really? So how did you save that person?
Well, I managed to hold houses quite well and saved a few people from the shop, including a woman called Doris, who would later become my wife. And then I saw a lamppost fall down and Ian was near it. I pushed him out of the way so he wouldn't be injured by the post.
Oh.
Boyce listened through the wall. He understood how Steele felt in that moment. He realised that his boasting to the others made him seem unpleasant towards him and felt quite guilty for doing so.
After that happened, everyone in the area applauded and cheered for me. I even gained Ian's respect that day.
Oh, so did you get the medal?
I did. A few days passed and a ceremony was held. The medal is currently at home, but it was something similar to Sam's. But I do keep the newspaper from that day to remind myself that I did something great, and that was what caused me to transfer to Pontypandy a few years later and became a station officer. Although Boyce was still more capable of doing things than me, so that's why he became chief officer, while I was good enough to become a station officer.
Oh, I see.
And I'd like to apologize if my orders can come across as rude. My military training helped me a lot with my skills, and it makes me think it could be the same. I see potential in you, Cridlington, and I know you can be a good fireman, really. I just want you to try and follow my footsteps.
It's quite all right, sir. I'll try my best not to get distracted, but I still want to prove I'm good in the fire service.
Well, all I can say is try and do what you currently are doing and focus on details the best you can.
All right then, sir.
Right, I suppose it's time we get back to the table. The others must be wondering what's going on.
Elvis and Steele went outside the office, while Boyce, quickly and silently, sat back onto a chair.
Hello, you two. Everything all right?
Definitely.
Yes, just a chat, that's all.
Basil, I would like to say sorry if I seemed rather pompous recently. Being chief officer can get to my head.
It's quite all right. Still, all's well that ends well.
Steele and Boyce shook hands, and Steele and Elvis sat down. They started to chat away and had a good laugh, and for a long, long time, Steele and Boyce felt like good old friends once again.